September 14. We're joined now from Brisbane by the National Senate leader, Barnaby Joyce. Barnaby Joyce, before we get to election timing and the announcement today, I do want to get your impressions on how things are going with the floods there in Queensland. I know today you've been in Ipswich having a look around there, and you'll be in Bundaberg tomorrow. What's the situation like from what you've seen, and are locals getting the support they need?
Well, what amazes me, David, is they're back into it straight away. They're stocking their shops up straight away. They're getting their businesses running straight away. I went out and I was talking to a workshop that had been completely flooded out, and they had a Sparky there and a carpenter there already getting stuck into it, trying to get the show back on the road. So I admire that in them. There are concerns in regards to insurance, and I think that will be ventilated more and more in the next coming weeks of who's got coverage and who hasn't, and the premiums that are being charged, and the excesses that have been asked for, and that's going to be a very big issue here in Queensland, right from the north of our state to the bottom of our state. And of course Bundaberg, they were hit very badly, and most tragically we find that six people have lost their lives, which two farm workers are the latest ones in the Gatton Valley, which is obviously extremely sad and harrowing for their families, and they're at the forefront of my mind at the moment.
Yeah, that is terribly sad news. Unfortunately, as you point out, there are insurance issues and then how to pay for some of the damage here. 2 years ago, with the even worse floods, the government put in a flood levy, which you opposed. What are your thoughts this time around, in particular the idea of something more permanent, a natural disaster fund of some sort?
Well, this flood is overall obviously not as exceptional as the previous flood, the 2011 flood, yet for many people it is extremely bad and it's caused immense damage. I think that any payment by a government should as much as possible be covered by good management within the government, and levies always strike a chord of, you know, we have been imprudent, we are incompetent, we don't have the money put aside for a rainy day, therefore we're going to hit everybody else up for that money. I like governments that are prudent enough to have the money put aside all the time, but with the debt that this government's got itself into, in, you know, about $260 billion in debt as we speak, of course they'll run around trying to flog money off other people.
Well, that segues us nicely into the election year. Now, the Prime Minister, as we've been reporting, has announced September 14 is when voters will head to the polls. What do you make of this announcement? Very unusual to get it confirmed so early.
Now, this is like the person coming into the workplace and announcing to everybody that they're going to have a baby in about 9 months' time. Talk about announcing the pregnancy in the first week. Why is she doing this? What is the tactical reason of stating the bleeding obvious? We have to have an election then anyhow. I mean, it's got to happen by November. So what's on? To me, it reeks of a lady sandbagging her position against potential challenges for the leadership. That's the only thing I can think of. Even if I was in the Labor Party, they've lost all their tactical adroitness. There's no surprises now. It's either going to be on September the 14th or they're going to change the leader. They're your two choices. The Labor Party will change the leader before the September the 14th, or it'll be on September the 14th. And I think there'll be a few people asking the first question.
Doesn't it give business, everybody else, some certainty about when the election will be? And put a bit more focus on the actual policy debate rather than the guessing game over the date itself?
No, I don't know whether it does. I mean, the Prime Minister could say nothing and it'd be the bleeding obvious that they have to have an election before November. I mean, what is the purpose? This is so bizarre. Who in the history of our nation has announced an election so far out? What is behind this? I mean, for me, Spearsy, it came to me because someone rang me up and said, what are your views on the election? And I basically said, well, wait till it's called. And they said, well, it just has been. And I said, oh, right, well, what, about 5 weeks away? They went, no, end of the year. No, it's just bizarre.
Well, what is it going to mean for your policy priorities now? Does it mean that we will see coalition policies a bit earlier than the 5 minutes to midnight that they're usually delivered?
Well, let's hope that for my part, for the National Party's part, we will be making sure that we are driving policy agendas to do with regional Australia. Well, obviously the dams issue will be prominent, making sure we get regional development up and running, make sure we inspire people to move to our north, make sure we build the infrastructure corridors that are going to take our nation forward and build the size of the economic cake in Australia. Things that are tactile, that people are interested in. We're not terribly interested in the sort of, you know, we hope it doesn't turn into some sort of wallow in puerile personal politics, but I've got a funny feeling it might head off in that direction. I want to make sure that we give the Australian people a substantive policy agenda that talks about policy things that take our nation forward. And my role within the National Party is to make sure that we drive issues in the National Party and take people kicking and screaming to make people's lives better out west.
Just picking up on some of those items you list there, what about zonal taxation? Is that something still under consideration?
Well, we had it as one of the things we offered at the last election and negotiation with the independents. It is a policy of the National Party. We want to make sure we drive an agenda. We already have a zonal rebate scheme. It is something that we have to closely look at and make sure that we take this zonal rebate scheme into the 21st century. We all acknowledge that for this economy to grow, we must do a greater job at attracting people to the north, to the disparate areas, where our wealth really is, where the coal is, where the iron ore is, where our future lies in proximity to Asia. These are the sort of policy debates that can make our nation a greater place, a stronger place, a wealthier place, so we can pay off the debt that the Labor Party has left us. That's the sort of visionary things I think the Australian people want in general. They're the sort of debates that I just can't wait to get involved with.
But just to put this simply, some sort of incentive to move to these areas is something, whether it's a tax incentive or a rebate or whatever, is something that you will be offering at the election.
Well, we already have one, and it's so out of date. It's a 1948 policy, and we've got to make sure that we take it into the 21st century. We had a policy of a trial of 5 local government areas for zonal taxation at the previous campaign. I want to make sure that that policy remains on the agenda. It's a test case to try and make sure we take things forward. I think that everybody acknowledges that we have to do work to develop our north, because that is where our nation's future lies. That is the area that's proximate to Asia. And this is part of things that are constructive at an election campaign that I look forward to being part of. It is, it's policy of the National Party, has been for a while. Our job within the National Party is to drive it as an agenda, to make it coalition policy. And Julia Gillard tells me that I've got nearly a year to do it.
Well, one of the policy priorities for Tony Abbott has been a more generous paid parental leave scheme. I know regional seats probably won't benefit a huge amount from that. Are you happy to see that as a top priority?
No, look, it's really important that we have opportunities for those in the workforce to have a child and come back and still have a house. It is no point someone dropping out of the workforce to have a child and then finding that the income requirements for that household to maintain their house are lost in such a way that they either lose the house or they lose the opportunity to have a kid. Now, I want to make sure that everybody in Australia has the capacity to have a child and build a family, because the only people who are going to support you and me, Spearsy, when we retire are the kids, and if we're not having them, you and I are going to be hungry old fellas later on.
Well, let's hope that's a while off yet. Barnaby Joyce, thanks for that, and good luck in Bundaberg tomorrow. We appreciate you joining us this afternoon.